And welcome back. I'm the RPG Chick. We are in the Order of Truth headquarters. I don't know. Just finished speaking to Salamari. And we got a new... a new quest for the Anechoic Lazarae. Salamari, an old friend of the Changing God, has been investigating a gilded structure in the Reef of Fallen Worlds, which she calls the Anechoic Lazarae. Recently, someone seems to have broken inside and caused some sort of trouble. She asked me to enter the structure, find out what has gone wrong, and make it safe to continue her research. The Lazarae is an ornate gilded structure in the Reef of Fallen Worlds. Salamari gave me a metallic iron that should serve as a key to open its door. Yeah, if it's that thing, that huge thing that looked like a, I don't know, some kind of ship or something, but it was like alive, I'm not even sure. So I think I might know what it is. Interesting how we can't look at anything in here, not yet anyway. Let's talk to Min of Tan Liang. Hail. I think he's the leader of this order. This priest is tall, thin, and dressed only in black. Narrow slashes of oil decorate his unlined skin like letters in an unknown tongue. His eyes are harried, but alive with intelligent humor. They land on you with a tiny flicker of recognition. He thinks, she's back? I wonder what brings her here now. Then his gaze moves from you to your companion. Hello, Calistej. Here to work or just visit? He thinks, and with the husk? I hope this isn't a long-term visit. Calistez says, just a bit of business. Have you ever heard anything about a resonance chamber, Min? We're looking for a way to repair one. You're what? He gasps. I thought that thing was a myth. And you're trying to repair it? Where is it? He thinks, is that what she and Salamari were working on? I'd love to see that. I'd rather not say. Ah, he says, his mouth twisting. Probably wise. Anyway, do you have any piece of the machine with you? I have a shard of it. Take a look. Yeah, he's a little too eager to look at it, so I decided not to expose that. He handles the shard with care. Organic and crystalline. It was grown into the appropriate shape for the machine. This is definitely what Salamari was working on all these years ago. With her partner. He looks at you. His eyebrow raised, but does not say more. Right, who is this Adan who looks just like me? Reluctantly, he hands it back to you. He thinks, it must be her then. But why lie? I'll ask Salamari about it later. Well, then he'll find out where the chamber is anyway by asking her. Unless Salamari doesn't want to say. In all honesty, I focus on more on traditionally powered machines. Salamari has some experience with organic machine construction. You might ask her about it. Yeah, I've already done so. Tell me about that machine behind you. It makes Levies. The Guardians of Sagas. Oh. He rubs his chin. Our records say that Deviaticu found a similar device in the ruins of Archipelagia, far to the north. He convinced the city that a local version, a modified one, would be of use. In order to become a citizen, everyone in Sagas Clefs, even the ones born here, gives a year of their lives to the machine. It uses that borrowed time to create a levy. What if someone only has 1 year to live? Would they die the second they entered the machine? Gold and blue tide. So I'm a good girl and an intelligent girl. No, he frowns. They'd never die in the machine, but it catches up with them a few days later. That doesn't happen very often. Sometimes I think the machine actually saves them, prevents them from meeting whatever fate was in store, but not always. At any rate, the levies created by the machine are nearly identical, and they only last a year. After that, they quietly return to the machine and dissolve into... His hands grip the air, trying to frame the words. Gray... gunk. It's incredibly unpleasant to watch, but they don't seem to mind. They deserve more than a year of servitude. Gold again. I don't know that they deserve anything, he says. They're not alive in the general sense. They don't ask for time off or complain about the cold. They just serve their time and melt away. Like golems or something. Anyway, that's the machine. Any other questions? What does it do again? It takes a year of life from people when they're old enough to become Sega citizens. The machine then shapes that time into levies that patrol and protect the city. Who should I ask about the resonance chamber again? Salamary. She's worked on organic machine construction before. So ask about something else. Happy to, he says. What is it? Can you tell me about your work? Heh, he says, shaking his head. That's a big question, even on the best days. I specialize in mechanical Numenera, intelligent or not, but I haven't had much time for research since I started managing our branch of the Order. Can I ask you some questions about mechanical Numenera? I would be incredibly grateful if you did, he says. Every other conversation I have revolves about how I'm ruining the Order, or not doing enough to save the Order. He rubs his forehead with the back of his calloused hand. Please, ask me about wires and blinking lights. I can't. Wait. Can I ask you some questions? I guess this is the Levy machine is the mechanical Numenera and the resonance chamber. Never mind. We've gone back into something that yet he acted like it's the first time. Okay, never mind. What is the Order of Truth? Good question. He chews his lip for a moment, framing his words. We live on the surface of a vast labyrinth of layered ruins, packed with relics and artifacts. Windows into the past. Some people are content to find them, use them, and sell them. He grins. But not the Order of Truth. Not the Aeon Priests. We want to understand the Numenera, study them, point at them, and argue about them. Now, in the West, the Order of Truth is much bigger than this little enclave. It's a vast organization, led by the Amber Pope. Out there, our words turn the heads of kings. He shrugs. Around here, we occasionally get discounts on equipment from local vendors and a free cup of tea. Not that I'm complaining. How did a chapter of the Order of Truth end up out here? It was founded 300 years ago by a Vargellan Nanu named Diviatiku. That's his statue outside. He governed, or you could say ruled, the Order with more force than you see in traditional chapters. He set us up in this spire, handpicked new members, and chose them for particular projects of his design. Now, of course, we met Diviatiku in the clock... what was it called? The clock fathom. They were inside that clock, and we helped them get out. Along with ourselves. We're not quite that organized these days, he says, shrugging. For better or worse, leaders are chosen by consent of the other priests and priestesses, and they don't have a say in what everyone works on. They just deal with the politics and the paperwork so that everyone else can focus on their ruinous side projects and hideously dangerous experiments. He flashes a grin. Which is to say, I'm the leader because I'm the only one who admits we need to eat. Leadership is a lonely path. Silver Tide, tiny amount. I wish that were true, he says. I'm rarely lonely. People visit me all the time, usually furious and waving their hands. But someone has to deal with the world outside these walls. The slave families, for some reason, aren't interested in funding wild, endless experimentation. They like results, especially weaponizable ones. So I review their requests, deflect the crazier ones, and convince my colleagues to work for a living occasionally. He nods at the nearby machine. We also create the levies that guard the city, though that's seen more as a responsibility than a favor these days. Again, I know what this means. I just want to hear what he says. What are levies? They're Sagus's version of a city watch. You may have seen them around. He plasters on a wide, fake grin and points at it. They wear armor and look like this. You can't miss them. I like this guy. He's cool. Good to see. No. It's a shame the Order has to earn its keep in this city. Silver Tide. Well, it has its ups and downs, he says, shrugging. Some of our people could use some grounding. He scratches his head absently. What else do you want to know about the Order? I just want to go over this again. They are an organization dedicated to discovery, understanding, and appreciation of Numenera. What are they doing? Vegas Cliffs. We advise the slave families on technological matters and maintain the machine that produces Levies. Are there a lot of Aeon priests in Sagas Cliffs? Yes, but they're not strictly here, he says. Some are out on digs or various expeditions. We only have a few Aeon priests in the city right now. There's Salamari, who I mentioned before. Belazar studies mechanical life forms. Orth Fong is an expert in inexplicable and malicious architecture and should be back soon. Just that sentence is funny. Orth Fong is an expert in inexplicable and malicious architecture and should be back soon. He pauses, ticking his fingers and furrowing his brow. And Sinurf, of course. A visitant who's developed an interest in all forms of reproduction. It isn't one of us, and I don't think it wants to be, but we give it space to work on its projects. He leans in. Don't go over there unless you've invented a way to scrub your memory clean. Too late! I can't unknow it. Ah, also, Lan Yuring, of course. He's been educated in the Order, but he's still looking for a discovery that will make him an Aeon Priest. Members? You're better off just talking to them yourself, he says, grinning. Not a one of them is shy about telling you what they know. I saw Diviatiku inside the clock in Circus Minor. Your founder was the Changing God. Or a cast-off.
My studies have borne fruit.
Ooh. Calistair's was leveled up, I think. He squints at you, then the ceiling. It's possible, he says at last. Diviatiku's behavior matches the stories I've heard about the Changing God, but he hasn't exactly shown up here to pick up where he left off. He shrugs. If you're right, maybe he just lost interest. Oh, yeah. I don't even remember talking to him. I met an Aeon priest named Belazar. He's up to something in Circus Minor, but he wouldn't tell me what it was. Is he still there? He seems genuinely surprised. I was hoping he'd given up, run off, and we'd never see him again. No, I don't really mean that. Well, maybe a little. That boy has been obsessed with biomechanical monsters for as long as I've known him. Oh, Belazar with the Nycthemeron. Right? And now a real one has fallen into his lap. He's trying to get himself a physical sample, I think. Oh, he's the one trying to get the sample. We need to talk to that thing at night, the Nycthemeron. Tell you what, if you see him again, you can say that I've sent you to give him a hand. That'll bring him around. And gods know he needs whatever help he can get. He's brilliant with the books. He shakes his head. But not much else. Salamari told me there's a Memovera spy in the Order of Truth. We think so, he says with an irritated glance at Salamari. But not because we've seen people in dark cloaks creeping around. He lowers his voice, but not enough that the anger buried in it is completely hidden. We've lost dig sites to her thugs. Maybe people, too. We can't be sure because we never find any traces of them. He rubs his forehead with a stained hand. We'll catch that spy, he says. Only a matter of time. More questions about the Order of Truth, maybe? Nope. Fare thee well. Come back anytime. Okay, now we can look at the stuff.
Of course.
This machine is a chaotic assemblage of metal tanks and tubing, a work table mounted with spare parts or mounding. Okay, the spare parts mounded on it. There's mounds of spare parts on it. God. and it's connected by wires to an oddly familiar sarcophagus and other devices. Do they want us just picking through this stuff? Examine the machine. As it turns out, there is very little to examine. Every access point to the machine has been carefully sealed. Some of the hatches and panels are worn with use. They are likely accessed by the Order when they perform maintenance on the machine. Others are gleaming, ornate locks with twisted keyholes, unmarred by the scratches and nicks of careless, everyday use. You run your hands across its surface and feel the ghost of another person's hands doing the same. Anamnesis. Try to determine why this machine looks so familiar. Nope. Memories drift past like cobwebs, teasing the corners of your mind. They dissolve into dust as you grasp for them. Try again. I think it's important.
My studies have borne fruit.
Good. Alright, I gotta level up people. The memory opens like a gaping mouth and closes around you. Hot wind pulls at your robes. Jagged grit claws at your eyes. Squinting through the storm, you see the machine, half buried in the sand. Curiously, you wedge open a panel. Inside is a sphere, sparkling like a jewel, but sorfed to the... Life drains from you into the sphere like blood from a wound. The machine is stealing your life. Growling, you return the favor, ripping the sphere from the machine and regarding it with cold eyes. The memory releases you abruptly, leaving you panting in front of the machine, which is not the ruined monstrosity your predecessor discovered in the Arcopalasian ruins. You know, however, that the orb is sealed somewhere inside this device. Examine again. You wrap your knuckles experimentally on the side of the machine. The sound reverberates through the hollow space within, echoing and echoing into inaudible eternity. Huh. So hollow or sphere inside? Pick through the spare parts on the table. You sort through the jumbled components on the table. There aren't many, nor are there any duplicates. These appear to be spare parts for the machine. Knock on the machine again. The sound bounces around inside the hollow machine like a rock falling down an infinite well. Alright, never mind. Let's... The thing sounds like it's getting louder. Alright, so I am... Blue and silver. Wisdom, reason, and enlightenment. Prestige, power, and renown. Gold is getting higher, though. Right. Calistash. So she's going to say that every time to remind us. Improved ability. Oh, no, we can't do that. We can only increase edge or extra effort. Max effort level 2 to 3. Or edge. Edge provides a bonus to all tasks and challenges that use a particular stat. For each point of edge in that stat, you can use one level of effort at no stat pool cost. Edge also reduces the activation cost of abilities, eventually making some free to activate. I can only choose speed or intellect. How about for her speed? And I guess that's all I do? Yeah. Okay. Let's look at these other things. I can't seem to be able to speak. This synth sarcophagus could hold a large human. Its surface is pitted as if it survived a sandstorm and the original color has worn away. The light that shines from within this strong glass chamber has a cruel and clinical glow. Its doors are firmly sealed. A mass of leathery flesh sags against the railing. Sharp probes are stuck into its skin, surrounded by festering sores that ooze a foul-smelling oil. Is this the after effect of when a levy has reached its year of service? Does it turn into this thing? Alright, let's look around some more. Go up here. I wonder if there's anyone else up here. In here. What is this thing? A small wireframe pyramid sits on a base of polished wood. Lying inside the pyramid is a dull sphere of silverish metal. Examine the sphere. Surrounded in its wire cage, the sphere is almost perfectly sized to fit in your palm. The gaps in the wiry mesh are large enough for you to reach through, though not large enough to pull the sphere out. Examine the frame. The frame appears to be fixed firmly in place. It's constructed of an organic material, grown in a manner similar to bone or coral. Thinner, vein-like strands of the material wind across each of its triangular sides. Something strikes you as odd about it, but you can't quite determine why. Try to discover what seems odd about the frame. I'm running out of, points here. Success! While examining the frame, you try nudging it gently, and it shifts in a most peculiar manner. You focus on moving the frame in various directions and discover that it can be easily lifted straight up off the base and lowered back down onto it, but it refuses to move laterally, even while being held in midair. Interesting. Examine the base. The base appears to be made from a slab of lurid red stone. On closer inspection, you recognize it as a petrified wood of some kind. An inscription has been written on the base in front of the pyramid. Examine the inscription. It's in an alien language. It has been burned into the wood and then filled with a luminous substance. Though you know you haven't seen the language in your own short life as a cast-off, it still seems familiar. Use anamnesis to try to recall where you've seen the language before. Oh, I'm like... I have, nothing. Oh, it worked. Oh, whoops. A distant memory surfaces. You're standing before a large metal cylinder that looms a meter or two above your head. The cylinder is a time capsule of sorts, and you're convinced that what lies within is critical to your latest experiments. The problem, alas, is that the capsule is locked, and the only clue to opening it is a series of strange glyphs etched into its sides. Glancing around, you see dusty tomes, faded banners, metal scraps, and dozens of other objects, all featuring the same strange glyphs. You've spent a lifetime collecting every trace of this language that could be found, and decades of study have finally led to this moment. You look upon the glyphs, and you know their meaning. Stepping forward, you reach toward the cylinder as prescribed by the etchings, and it flares to life. Shaking off the memory, you look down at the inscription and realize that its meaning is now clear. The crimson dawn greets the seeker. The violet dusk sees the search's end. Crimson dawn, violet dusk. Touch the sphere. As you extend your hand toward the sphere, the thinner strands along the front side of the cage retract toward the thicker frame edges, creating an opening large enough for the sphere to fit through. Okay, take the sphere. You pull the sphere out of the frame through the opening facing you. Are we stealing? And it immediately begins to glow a scintillating blue. You pause a moment to make sure there are no other effects. Blue. Knowledge and stuff. Then try to put it with the rest of your belongings. At some point, during this motion, the sphere simply vanishes, only to reappear within the frame, once again a dull gray. Apparently taking the sphere will not be quite so easy. Huh. Okay, so we pulled it out to the opening facing us. It glowed blue. We waited. And we were going to put it away, it vanishes. It turns gray. You pull the sphere out again, and once again it glows a brilliant blue before disappearing and returning to the frame. After a little experimentation, you discover that the sphere's position seems to reset whenever it moves beyond a particular distance from the device. As long as you keep it within that distance, as you are now, you can hold on to it. Read the inscription again. What the hell? Meaning is still clear. Yeah, same thing. Take the entire device with you. The device is far too bulky to carry around with you. As if reading your thoughts, Min looks over and shakes his head sadly while muttering something under his breath. Alright, let's put it back. As you place the sphere, something's happening, back in the frame, it changes to a vibrant orange color. It occurs to you that the sphere seems to respond to moving through the frame boundaries. Perhaps moving it through the other sides will produce additional results. Remove the sphere from the frame via the front opening. The sphere returns to a deep violet blue. Orange. Remove it from the left opening. Turns to lurid red. Putting it back goes violet. Right opening. Dull orange. Put back. Blazing orange. Back opening. Brilliant blue. Put back. Cool green. Remove from the bottom opening. Shining yellow. Put back that way. Indigo. Okay. It turns blue here. Oh no, that's violet. Indigo? Red. Violet. Okay, violet, and then left opening. Violet. I figured matching it would do something. Orange. Bright orange. Dull orange. Blazing orange. Back opening is blue and green. Yellow. Indigo. It's gotta be some reason we're doing this with different colors. Violet. Orange. Red. Violet. I did that. Matched violet and violet. Orange. Yeah, I was messing with the oranges. Blue. I'm just doing random crap right now. A guy must be sitting over there like, what the hell is she doing? Brute forcing here. I don't know what this means, guys. I don't know what I'm doing. I think I've skipped a few. I'm almost done. Imagine this guy watching, and she's like, what is she doing? On the bottom, left, bottom, right, bottom, back. what if I go... Wait. I'm wondering if the inscription will change. Oh, wait. The hint is in this. The crimson dawn greets the seeker. The violet dusk sees the search's end. Okay, so we remove it and get red somewhere. We want red and then violet. The second one is red and violet. No, that's orange. Second one, I forgot. Red, green, wait. Red, indigo. Oh. Oh wait, I'm supposed to put it back there, right? Red, red and violet. Oh, it's the same. I don't know, guys. I really don't know. Yellow and orange. Yeah, I don't know. As you step away from the device, the sphere dulls to its original silver. Let me just try one more thing. Okay, never mind. What else we got here?
Yes.
Oh, loot? Uh-huh. What is this? The Abhumans of the Sagus Protectorate. A study of savagery. The creatures known as Abhumans are believed to descend from human ancestors, but at some point in their history they became something else. Perhaps through mutation, directed breeding, or accelerated evolution. Unlike mutants, Abhumans have rejected their humanity and live as beasts, though some are very clever. Nearly all of them are violent and cruel, preying upon humanity when they can. Historically, two species of Abhumans have been common in the Sagus Protectorate. The first is the vile Murden, hunched and bird-like, with a sharp, dirty beak and a thick down of black feathers. Murdens subsist as thieves and murderers on the fringes of human society, rarely posing as organized threat to a community, but often ambushing lone victims or terrorizing isolated homesteads. They are incapable of speech, but they communicate with one another through a primitive form of telepathy that bleeds into the minds of everyone nearby, which can prove a dangerous distraction. Most of the time, Murdens are notorious cowards, preferring to flee if the odds are not clearly in their favor. The other Abhuman species that once prospered here is the Yovak. Short and squat with jaundiced skin, Yovaki hunt and kill for pleasure, and they eat whatever they kill. In the days when slavery was openly practiced in the Sagus Cliffs, bands of Yovaki were permitted to range across the frontier, raiding autochthonous tribes of humans and mutants, and taking captives to be sold in the flesh markets of the Bloom. The vicious Yovaki would sometimes rape their captives as well, and stories say that children were sometimes born from these pairings. My god. Tainting the bloodlines of certain families. After the rebellion of Chilla the Great, slavery was outlawed in Sagus Cliffs, and the Yovaki fled the Protectorate. They haven't been seen in centuries, but the people of Sagus still remember them, and any proof of a blood connection to their creatures is enough to destroy a family's reputation. Wow. Hopefully they don't mind that we take that. These books are piled haphazardly on the floor. They reflect a dozen areas of inquiry, most of which are entirely unrelated to each other.
Allow me.
Yeah, it's not me. This glowing display shows a globe, the ninth world, probably. Green lines depict trajectories that a ship could follow into the void between worlds. Interesting. This desk is tidy and neat. A book entitled Ecology of Biomechanical Hybrids is open to a sparse entry on the enigmatic Nixthemeron. This is where Belizar. This is his table, isn't it? Interact.
Let's go.
I got here an iPad or something. The desk is cluttered with scrawled notes, piles of paper, and worn books. The owner was extremely disorganized or left in a hurry. This looks like a melted iPad. Examine the papers and books, of course. You rustle through the mess of documents and notes. Most of them discuss the buildings and architecture of prior worlds. They are filled with drawings and descriptions of the bizarre structures uncovered by scholars and explorers. The owner of this desk seems to have been particularly interested in doors, door frames, and archways. He has drawn circles around all such things, but his scrawled comments are never more revealing than similar but not a match, or could there be a connection there? Was he looking for more time portals? Like the house of whatever? Again, you scan the jumbled books and documents, but don't find anything new. Most of them describe the architecture of prior worlds. Anything resembling a door frame has been circled in brightly colored ink. You also notice a few letters in personal correspondence, but they appear to have been written in code, or perhaps in a foreign script that isn't familiar to you. Okay, down there. Is that it?
Absolutely.
Well, that's absolutely it, huh? That's this whole area. Now we can ask him something else, I think. I want to ask him about that globe. And that thing. Back anytime, he says. Well, I guess we're done in here.
Gladly.
So I suppose that will conclude this episode. We still need to help that guy. The guy who's being executed. Somehow. Maybe we can get the rally of the crowd. All my intelligence is gone, but maybe some might will help out. I don't know. Anyway, thanks for watching, guys. I just want to say I don't want to rest to get my points back. I'm afraid all the time will pass and this guy will die. Out of all the quests we have, that one seems to be, you know, the most time sensitive. I don't know how to get a council member's favor. Blue and silver. Oh, my tides. Okay. Thanks, guys. Thanks so much for watching. See you in the next episode and enduring. Grow strong.